sorry I can't be here in person due to a family commitment, but I think this is a really important information, so I'm glad to be sharing it with you. So this is the agenda for the talk. I want to talk about what we know about normal bone health, osteopenia and osteoporosis, think about how prostate cancer and hormone therapy affect the bones, and then to think about what we can do to keep bones healthy, including medication, supplements, and diet and exercise. So the bones have really two major functions. The first is sort of structural support. They're the scaffolding on which our bodies are built. But the bones also contain bone marrow, which is where our immune cells live, our red blood cells, our white blood cells. That's where they're born. And there's a lot of blood flow there. The bone marrow is actually concentrated in the thick, long bones. So the vertebrae, the femurs, the pelvis. And that actually explains why prostate cancer tends to metastasize to those areas, because they have the most blood flow compared to other bones in the body. The bones are alive and dynamic. And I think this is in contrast to what many people think of bones as just being the sort of dead matrix. There are multiple types of cells within the bones. Osteoblasts are what lay down bone and cause new bone growth. Osteoclasts destroy bone, they tear up bone, so they essentially cause remodeling of unnecessary bone. So when you're laying flat for a long period of time, for example, in the hospital, your bones actually thin out. Same thing happens to astronauts in space, and that's why they have to do lots of exercise to keep their bones strong. And the osteocytes are the little cells that are actually trapped within the bone. The bone sort of forms around those osteocytes, as you can see in the picture here. And they secrete a number of factors that help regulate this process. So osteopenia and osteoporosis are very commonly used terms. What do they mean? Well, so on the left here, you can see healthy bone, and you can see inside that the bone actually has a very strong scaffolding or support matrix. And this allows us to sort of respond to stresses without fracturing. Osteopenia is what happens when you have loss of some of that matrix, as you can see in the middle. And then osteoporosis is just a much more dramatic example of that. And folks who have that are much more at risk of fracture. So osteoporosis is really a syndrome of low bone mass and deterioration of the bone tissue, as you can see in the pictures here, an increased risk of bone fragility and of fracture. And really, this is a clinical diagnosis. So we need to do imaging like a Dexa scan, which I'll talk about in a second, to help us understand this better. So what causes bone loss in sort of otherwise healthy individuals? Well, there are a number of things. Tobacco and alcohol use, sedentary lifestyles, low vitamin D and low calcium diets. It seems to be that there may be some contribution of family history. And then there are a number of medical causes that you can see here on the screen. And perhaps the most important is really testosterone or estrogen lowering therapy, or one of the most important, I should say. And how this works is actually very complex. I think we're still understanding and learning about this. There are multiple different mechanisms at play, multiple cellular and chemical signals that are released. You can see many of them on the screen here. The one that we can probably intervene on the most here is the RANK-RANK ligand pathway. And for many of you who are either using denosumab or know someone who's taking denosumab, that's also called Xgeva or Prolia. Those are the trade names. This is a drug that interferes with the RANK-RANK ligand system and actually stops the osteocytes from chewing up bone. So it favors the deposition of bone and makes bone stronger and reduces fractures. So I sort of said this already, but why is osteoporosis bad? Obviously, there's a risk of fracture. Fracture at the hip or the vertebrae can be really symptomatic. That can lead to pain and physical debilitation, and you know, may require surgery or just prolonged recovery. That can be really, really awful. So this picture here is showing you different types of hip fractures, but you can get this in the spine as well. These are vertebral fractures, really what happens when the vertebrae themselves become too weak. So just to put this in context, so some numbers for men. For a man who's aged 50, there's about a 25% chance that he will have a fracture, an osteoporotic fracture, at some point in his lifetime. And the risk goes up dramatically with age. So after age 80, the risk becomes much higher. Sadly, screening for osteoporosis in men and in women is actually rarely done in the United States. And this sort of disappointing statistic is that only about 10% of men who've had a fracture are subsequently given a bone targeting agent, when in fact 100% of those men should get that. And this may be due to, you know, sort of underappreciation of the role of these agents in preventing future fractures. Now, just to continue those numbers, you can see on this slide that a hip fracture is a really awful event. So just going clockwise, 40% of people who have a hip fracture are unable to walk independently at subsequent points. 60% of them require assistance a year later. Up to a quarter of people who have a hip fracture will die in the first year after the hip fracture. So it's really a sign of a very serious event. 50% of patients who have a hip fracture will develop another one, really any osteoporotic fracture. And about a third of patients will be dependent or in a nursing home in the year following a hip fracture. So trying to avoid a hip fracture is obviously incredibly important in this field. Beyond just losing bone mineral density from hormone therapy, prostate cancer itself can cause a lot of direct effects on the bones. And this is a CT scan showing really, unfortunately, advanced stage prostate cancer where much of the bone has been destroyed by cancer. The healing bone that happens from this, even once it's treated, is not as strong. So men are just higher risk for fracture. And also, this is a talk about bone health, but bone marrow is incredibly important for our body, because that's where the red cells and the immune cells are made. And if we have too much cancer in the bones, that can really impact our immune systems and our ability to tolerate other therapy for prostate cancer. So specifically, low testosterone increases the fracture risk by anywhere from 20 to 40%. Other things that can cause damage to the bones: external beam radiation therapy is not good for the bones. Chemotherapy, our novel radioligand therapies like lutetium may damage the bone itself. And then, as I talked about, nutrition and smoking are very important too. So just to measure bone density, many of you may be familiar with the Dexa scan. This is essentially a series of x-rays of the hip, the spine, and sometimes the wrist. And it generates these scores called the Z-score and the T-score. And really the T-score is what we're looking at. This compares the results to a young, healthy, sex-matched comparison. And basically, the numbers at the bottom are really important. For a T-score greater than negative 1 is considered normal. A T-score between negative 1 and negative 2.5 is osteopenia. And a T-score less than 2.5 is osteoporosis. So the numbering and the numbers here are a little challenging to interpret sometimes, but these are really what we're looking at. Now, you can get a DEXA scan, and this can tell you have one of these three types of conditions of the bones. But really, what's important is understanding what's the fracture risk. And there's a very useful calculator built on thousands of patients' data called the FRAX calculator. And I show it to you here. You can find it at the website on the slide here, where you can enter your age, your weight, your height, a number of clinical questions about prior fracture, and the T-score. And then that'll tell you what the actual risk of fracture is. And you can see that here in the red box over the next 10 years. So these really tell us who to treat. So for a man who's had a prior hip or vertebral fracture, almost all of them are recommended to be treated. For patients who have osteoporosis on DEXA, those are patients who are generally recommended to be treated as well. And then for patients who have osteopenia and this high FRAX risk, are also recommended to be treated. So I think this can be a really useful tool. Now, what can we do to stop bone loss beyond these medicines? Well, so I think monitoring is really important. So making sure we have adequate vitamin D, you can check that on a blood test. The DEXA score and the FRAX score, I told you, just talked to you about how we can generate that. The general recommendation for dietary supplements is 1200 milligrams a day of calcium and at least 400 units of vitamin D. I generally give men 800 units because I find that lowers the chance that they're going to have low vitamin D levels. We also see low vitamin D levels in the Bay Area because a lot of people don't get enough sunlight exposure. You can get this through dairy, through nuts, nut milks, lentils, salmon, leafy greens, or a lot of foods that are high in vitamin D. And I encourage you to look at the nutritional label when you're buying foods and see how much vitamin D is there. Protein is also important for healthy bones and healthy muscles. And then avoiding tobacco, avoiding alcohol, and doing weight-bearing exercise, really important. Now here at UCSF, we've had a number of studies led by Stacy Kenfield, Aaron Van Blarigan, and June Chan looking at different types of exercise and diet for prostate cancer. This has been very helpful for many men. And then there are a number of therapies, bisphosphonates like zoledronic acid, RANK ligand inhibitors like denosumab, and calcium and vitamin D supplements can be very helpful as well. And you can see some information about these on the slides here. So just in summary, monitoring is really important. Getting DEXA scans every 2 years in men who don't have bony metastases is helpful. Checking vitamin D levels, thinking about lifestyle, diet, weight-bearing exercise are really important. And then the recommendations for calcium and vitamin D, and then thinking about bone strengthening agents, which are indicated for men who have MCRPC regardless of their DEXA score, or for men with osteoporosis or high-risk osteopenia. So with that, I just want to say thanks. Sorry again that I'm not present on site today, and I hope it's a good discussion.